Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Gotta Love This Country, written by Peter FitzSimons and read by David Tredinnick. Introduction. It was a Friday, nudging on 20 years ago. There I was, about to head out to lunch, when my Sydney Morning Herald sports editor, Steve Meacham, called across the editorial floor, "Paul's not in today. Can you do inside running?" Bugger. Inside running was the light wrap-up of the week's sporting events, which I had no particular interest in. But, yes, boss. I smashed it out in about 45 minutes flat, once over lightly, throwing together the news of the week, the best quotes, a couple of sporting vignettes, a bit of a rant on something or other, and I'll tell you who was my uncle. Bob was my uncle. And I made it to the lunch. Come the Monday, back at the office, a strange thing was happening. There was a huge reaction. Phone calls, letters, compliments from colleagues, and from the editor-in-chief. Why not do it again this week? Yes, boss. This time I actually put some time into it, and some effort, and the reaction was even stronger. Somehow this kind of itsy-bitsy journalism, constantly changing angles and subjects, suited my short attention span and that of many readers. I soon took over the whole thing every week, and Steve renamed it the Fitz Files. In no time at all, I loved it, and it became my focus, gathering yarns throughout the week. But now, here's a funny thing. Always, the thing that got the biggest reaction was not my newsy bit, nor my rants, nor my bits of philosophical sporting whimsy. No, what people most loved, it seemed, was the heartwarming stuff. The stuff far away from sport's elite level and back to the grassroots. Sport, the way sport was always meant to be. I started out using a "Gord, I love this city" riff to introduce each section, which soon morphed into "Gotta love this city," and then "Gotta love this country." The broad idea was to celebrate all the great things about sport, at all levels. To note with wonder how lucky we all are to be able to enjoy them, with all their quirks, colour and romance. I do hope you enjoy the reading, as I have enjoyed the writing. Peter FitzSimons. Who was that beanied balladeer? The scene is a packed railway carriage pulling out of the station after the Springboks have been put to the sword. At one end of the carriage stands a huge South African man in a bock jersey and beanie, with a slightly crestfallen look, and carrying, of all things, a huge piano accordion. Opposite him stand two slightly drunken Australian supporters in wallaby jerseys. They look at him. He looks at them. One of the Australians then speaks. "Come on, Mr. Piano Accordion Man, how about a tune?" The South African immediately brightens. He begins to play and sing. Fantastically. The Lion Sleeps Tonight. In short order, the entire carriage is singing, clapping and stomping along to song after song as Strathfield, Summerhill and Petersham stations fall back in the night to the sounds of "She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain," "If I Was a Rich Man," "House of the Rising Sun," etc. As an interlude, the bloke sings an opera aria in rich baritone and also a South African folk tune to which all his countrymen in the carriage sing along, while the Australians simply laugh and clap along to the beat. When he makes to sit down nearing Newtown Station, the entire carriage roars for more, and he obliges as they proceed, rockin', rollin', ridin' all the way to Central. People leave the carriage, still singing, each one warmly thanking the bloke for his efforts. He glows appreciatively in return and disappears into the night. Gotta love this country. Hell and leather. As part of the host city marathon, I was in the last gaggle of the 5,500 runners struggling up Oxford Street just after 7 a.m, huffing and puffing and sweating up a storm, when a large group of leather whips and chains boys were emerging from an obviously torrid all-night session at one of the clubs just up from Whitlam Square. Both groups regarded each other a little warily, and then the leather men started clapping us and cheering very good-heartedly, only to receive equally warm cheers from the runners. Fellow sufferers all, there was instant empathy between us. At that moment, the first of the wheelchair racers came zooming down the other side of the road with the rising morning sun on their backs and the whistling wind in their hair to be cheered by the whole damn lot of us. Let us pray. Billy Freeman was attending the Bulldog Souths games at the Sydney Showground and standing in a queue to get food at half-time when he saw what he describes as the strangest sight I've ever seen at a football game. A Muslim man, aged about 20 to 21, wearing a Canterbury jersey and a reversed baseball cap, was kneeling on his prayer mat facing Mecca and worshipping Allah on the concourse of the Eastern Grandstand. With the hysteria surrounding people of the Muslim culture created by politicians lately, I was worried he may be abused or something. But to their credit, people, albeit a bit bemused, left him alone. I am told he made it back in time for the second half kickoff. Golden Oldies bowled over on flight of fancy. Just a few weeks ago, the old and the bold from the Hunters Hill Cats Golden Oldies rugby team were on a flight bound for some rugby revelry on the Gold Coast, and one of my spies was there. The fact that the airline had not spotted them as a rugby team was likely due to the fact that they had booked as lady bowlers and therefore were all seated together. Mistake. Big mistake. The flight attendants on that day were headed by the truly gorgeous Brenda. And as the drinks trolley did its job, and the Golden Oldies focused progressively more on her lovely form, they soon forgot their baldness, creaking joints, and obesity, and were taken back to their youth. Back as far as 1977, when they had gone through the entire season undefeated. The more they gazed at Brenda, the more they remembered, until somewhere about 9,000 metres over Tweed Heads, it happened. From the midst of this drooling mob came, "Hey, Brenda, what's your mother's phone number?" Mall rats. Roy Dunlop was at Castle Hill Shopping Mall last week, 6th of July 2002, 1 week after the 2002 FIFA World Cup had concluded, when he took a well-earned rest. Dum-de-dum-dum-dum, watching the passing parade. Then, suddenly, he realised he was sitting opposite a family of five. Mum, Dad, two teenage boys, and a teenage girl. An obvious domestic was in progress, and I was riveted to my seat with that cool and oppressive feeling one gets on such an occasion. Just as I was starting to make my exit, Mother turned to teenage daughter and said, "Are you really telling me that you are supporting Germany in the finals on Sunday?" Serenaded. I have been reliably informed that 2 weeks ago, when Carlton took on the Fremantle Dockers in an AFL match, John Elliott, the former Elders IXL, Carlton and Liberal Party boss, turned up with a notably gorgeous young woman. Cue Raymond Chandler. She was a blonde for a bishop to kick a hole in a stained glass window for. What did the Frio crowd do? All together, they stood and warmed to a chorus of Joe Jackson's song, "Is She Really Going Out With Him?" Olympic rings. A couple of weeks ago, I gratuitously asked whether, besides Princess Mary and Prince Watsit and Roger Federer and his new wife Mirka, did any other happy couple first meet at the Sydney Olympics? And how funny I should say that, because I am told that early in 2000, a bloke by the name of Richard, just back from 2 years backpacking, scored a job in the media centre, imagining that he would have unrestricted access to each and every athletic event, interspersed with free beer and love, and perhaps a little work, only to find 20-hour days sweating it out in the production room. The only thing that made it tolerable was an attractive brunette journalist by the name of Michelle, who would pop in to say hello. Just 12 months later, they married, and baby number 4 is due in a few months. At their wedding was Richard's mate, Lucas, who had also met a charmer by the name of Peter while attending an event at the Olympics, and they were soon married too, and also have 4 kids, a mortgage, and have just acquired a minivan. 1 Olympics, 8 kids, 2 minivans. First try to Martha. On the banks of St. Joseph's College main oval last Sunday afternoon, a day after the Riverview First 15 had defeated Joey's before about 15,000 people, the Joey's class of 1983 found themselves gathering for a barbecue to celebrate the end of their 20-year reunion weekend. The steaks went down a treat, as did the wine and beer, and, as the sun shone strong, the years fell away. So, what the hell? Why not play a bit of a muck-around game of footy on the main oval, as they did in days of yore? So they did. The only slightly odd thing was the attractive woman who scored the first try. She was not a wife or a girlfriend, but rather a former classmate who, after a brief period of not knowing whether she was Arthur or Martha, had decided on Martha, and soon after school finished, had the gender-altering operation. Of course, it goes without saying that Martha was a winger when at school, but she was warmly welcomed back the night before by the 100 former classmates who attended the reunion, with not one stray bit of bigoted nastiness. It was admirable, as were the 1,000 or so Joey's boys, who stood and applauded Riverview on the previous day after their deserved GPS victory. Thomas the Trier bowls them over. You will remember when you and I were young, how our dearest dream was to wear the baggy green. You will sense, as I do, that that desire is not as universal as it was. Still, I like the story of Thomas Mulheron, a 9-year-old who plays in the Pitt Town under-11s in the Hawkesbury cricket competition. Throughout this, his first season of playing, he has practiced every afternoon with his older brother and mother out in the backyard. A fortnight ago, the mighty Pitt Town made the final series and the entire family ventured out for the game. Though disappointed to be selected as 13th man, he still stayed at the ground for the entire day with his mum, cheering his team on to victory. Tom kept practicing all the following week and never breathed a word about the disappointment of not playing. Last Sunday was the final. This time, 12th man. Though he still can't get a bat, he can still get to bowl and field under the competition rules, which is really something. With the whole family watching and willing him on, young Tom, the youngest and near smallest on the team, finally gets his chance as the skipper throws him the ball. Tom runs in, the ball leaves his hand well, shimmies, dives, bites the pitch and bursts forth. A swish, a snick, a dive, an appeal. Good style. Doug Sharp writes, "The Brownlow Medal is when AFL footballers take a back seat to their wives or girlfriends, and lots of cleavage makes for voyeur TV. But who did our own Swanee medalist Adam Goods take as his date? His mum." Gotta love this country. Wigs off. On Saturday night at the Sydney Football Stadium, before the kickoff.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.